Now, having covered coordinates, we can move into some of the most essential parts of astronomy and astrophysics, which will allow us to quantify the energy from stars and many other objects. The first of such quantities is actually luminosity. Luminosity is something you could call intrinsic. It is defined as energy per second, so this is basically power. And typically when you write L as on the top, we are typically referring to bolometric or total luminosity. So this is the reason why sometimes you will actually see above subscripts of some wavelength or some frequency that indicates that the luminosity is not bolometric, but most likely refers to that specific band. And we're going to have and see examples of it. Sometimes luminosity can also be per wavelength or frequency, but if that is the case, I will also point out. Now, the units of luminosity in the international system are very simple. They're just joules per second or watt. Now, in astronomy, we do use CGS a lot, and I'll explain why that is the case. And in CGS, the units of luminosity are erg per second, where an erg per second is equivalent to 10 to the minus 7 watts. And I'll try to explain why we use these units apart from we're out of our damn minds. We'll come back to this. But in most situations, we're actually going to assume that the luminosity of a source, for example, a star, is typically emitted isotropically. And this means that it is emitted in the same amounts in all directions. And typically we use this assumption when we can only see energy from a given direction, and then we want to retrieve the full energy per second, the full power or luminosity of a source. And as I've already mentioned, sometimes luminosities will be for a specific band, such as in the blue or B bands, or in the radio at a specific frequency, like you have here at 1.4 gigahertz, or in the X-ray where you denote it with an X, or perhaps an emission line such as H-alpha. But we will discuss this further, of course. One of the very important things to realize is that luminosity is not something that we can very easily retrieve or measure. This is because luminosity or energy per second or power, say from a star, will be spreading over a surface of a sphere and it will essentially propagate in three dimensions. This means that this energy per second, especially the energy per second we'll get on a specific area, will be decreasing as the distance increases. Now, because of the way that energy propagates, when you go to a distance that's twice as far, you're actually retrieving an energy per second per area that is four times as small. So in a concrete example, if you have a 1 meter square detector, you're only receiving a quarter of the luminosity per area at twice the original distance. The reason for this is because the luminosity that you can see right here will be spreading in three dimensions with the 1/d² law. So what the things that we will be measuring typically, which will be energy per second per area, will be given by this F that we'll come back to. For now, I think the important thing is to define what we mean when we talk about distances and specifically about luminosity distance, which can be obtained by the ratio or the square root of the ratio between the luminosity or intrinsic energy and 4 pi times something we could measure on a detector at a distance. Now, what is this F? This F is what in astronomy and astrophysics we call flux. We can think of flux as being defined in terms of a luminosity, as you can see here, where D is the luminosity distance. Once a source emits a certain luminosity, that energy is spread over three dimensions. And after a distance D, what you measure is a flux, which is L over 4 pi d². This is energy per second per area, hitting, for example, a detector. In the international system, these logical units will be joule per second per meter squared or just watt per meter squared. In CGS, we're looking at units of erg per second per centimeter squared. And you also have a conversion that 1 erg per second per centimeter squared is 0.001 watt per meter squared. The other thing to note is that flux is usually obtained after integrating a spectrum. We'll see how they look like, but when you disperse the light, typically what you get is something that we call flux density, and flux is what you obtain when you integrate over some wavelength or frequency. And flux is obviously an apparent quantity. The further away you are from the source, as you can see in the equation above, then the fainter the energy per second per area you're going to retrieve. Now, finally, as you can see here on the side, flux density is a quantity that's defined as being energy per second per area, so that's a flux, when you divide it per wavelength or frequency. So these flux densities can be per wavelength, that they are typically denoted as f nu, or they can be given in terms of frequency, and you can see here in terms of f nu with different units. So if you're talking about a flux density in terms of f lambda, you're typically looking at erg per second per centimeter square per armstrong. And if you're looking at something in terms of f nu, you're looking at erg per second per centimeter square per hertz. And below, you just have this very quick, clear notation that erg s minus one centimeter minus two really means erg per second per centimeter squared, just to be clear. I mentioned this already, but there is an important relation between the flux, which is the energy per second per area hitting a detector, and flux density, which is energy per second per area per wavelength or frequency. So the way that you can obtain, for example, a flux, if you have a spectrum of a source that's given an f nu, is actually by integrating the spectrum over a given wavelength. And typically these fluxes, which are integrals of flux densities, are defined for very specific wavelength ranges, or what in astronomy we call bands. In the optical, we will call them filters. So when we talk about a blue filter, what we're really talking about is something that only lets light through from some minimum wavelength to some maximum wavelength. What the filter is typically doing when you get some blue flux out of it is essentially doing this integral for you. But if you take a spectrum, you actually need to integrate it yourself. Consider this following example. And again, you have all the details in the lecture notes with even further explanations in case I miss something, but do get in touch if there's something you don't understand. In this case, this example shows you a spectrum. And this is a kind of an analytical spectrum that I made up in Python. But the units of spectra are typically flux densities. In this case, erg per second per centimeter square per armstrong. This is a relatively simple spectrum. And this flux density is given as a function of lambda. And in this case, whatever the source is, it has a rising flux density with wavelength. And if we want to calculate the flux at a specific band like this, so we're not defining it yet, but all we need to do is to integrate this spectrum from the minimum wavelength, in this case would be 5,000 armstrong to 6,000 armstrong. And this is what this example is asking you to do, which is to calculate the flux and luminosity for a band or filter defined between the wavelengths that we have here, with the extra information that the parallax of the source is 0.1 arcsecond, or the parallax angle. So you need to go back to one of the first things we covered in astronomy 263 and put your knowledge together to actually achieve this. Now, very simply, if you follow what we've covered so far, the flux for this band is just the integral between 5,000 armstrong and 6,000 armstrong. Because this is just a linear function of lambda, I hope that 112 is still fresh in your minds. But if not, this is a really simple integral that you can calculate and substitute to get the final answer, which is given as 1.75 times 10 to the minus 13. And this is erg per second per centimeter squared. The reason why we dropped the armstrong is because we integrated. So we basically multiplied and we took care of that. To calculate the luminosity, we need to know the relation between flux and luminosity, which is given here. So you need the distance, you're gonna square it, 4 pi. This is to do with how energy has been spread, but we measure this flux. So we have almost everything except the distance, but we're actually given what the parallax angle is. That's 0.1, because we're looking at the baseline of 1 AU, the distance has to be 10 parsec, and we can also transform it, if we want CGS, into centimeters, so that ultimately we calculate the luminosity of the source, which is 2.1 times 10 to the 27. And to be accurate, because this is not a bolometric luminosity, I've also indicated that this is L at 5,500 angstrom. So this is kind of the wavelength in between from the minimum and maximum. So I hope this is clear as a first example, but we'll come back to this and do slightly more complicated examples as well.